Hello, welcome, brothers and sisters, back to Gamer Church. I know I've been saying this for a while, but I think this is going to be the last night. I hope so. I've been really enjoying the game, but I am also ready to move on. It is a lot bigger than I expected. Going into it, I thought it was going to be like 4 hours of game, and it's been like 20 or 30, which was a pleasant surprise for a while, but I'm ready to get moved on. So, basic rundown of how the game has been going so far. We got into a gambling match with some kind of wolfman, and he cursed us to wander post-war America collecting stories for him. And he will free us from our curse once we have collected enough stories. And we have, I believe, collected most of them. We've got most of the main characters in the game have been... We've completed their stories. And the way the game works is we go and collect stories from all kinds of different events. We witness some, we hear them from others, and then we witness in real time these stories changing and evolving. As we re-encounter them again, they get retold by other people. It's a really cool and interesting situation. And the soundtrack and the voice acting are phenomenal. It's very, very, very good. I've been really enjoying it. So, let's get into it. That's not correct. There we go. That's correct. All right. Let's hit it. First thing I like to do is look around, make sure there aren't any new stories, and then we're going to look at the map. Because we are mostly just tracking down our last guys. If I remember correctly, we had a couple in the way northwest, and we can... I believe teleport to Washington. Which one is it? No, it's Washington, D.C. That's the wrong coast. Let's see, where are we? Yeah, Denver's the closest. But we're already really close to this guy. Well, kind of. Let's, is anybody up here northeast? Nope. Is there a... Man, we're kind of in the middle of nowhere. I think we're just going to head west. Talk to that guy over there. Is there anything we can pick up on the way? No, these are all stories that we've seen. Jeez. Okay. How's everybody doing tonight? Anansi moment? What are we talking about with Anansi moment? That's not a phrase that I've heard of. Thank you. We're not too far off. I think we'll get there pretty quick. So what's the longest you've ever had to walk, like accidentally? Like, I've been on backpacking trips where I like knew that I was going to have to walk. Can you think of a time when you were like not expecting to have to walk and, or like you got lost or something? Go to Seattle. There we go. You wait in this soup line for over an hour. It's barely crawling along. You round the corner of the building and see, far away, a lone pair of nurses struggling to ladle out soup to hundreds. "We'll be waiting here a while longer," sighs the mother in line beside you. You and her get talking. After a while, the topic drifts into a strange place, as she starts telling you about the miraculous canteen which provided water for a whole crew. You recognize it as the story about the water that turned into wine for the thirsty pickers, but way more outrageous than your version. You tell her your version. "That's not as exciting," she says diplomatically. "I mean, it sure sounds realer than what I heard, but I think Toby likes mine best." She bounces her child encouragingly on her hip, but Toby's too hungry to smile. So let's head south-southeast. My grandmother used to live out in the country outside of Stillwater. There we go. I gotta turn around a little bit. We rode our bikes out way, way out. Nothing stopping us, and we just kind of got sidetracked. Didn't really think about where we were going. And then I fell and broke the pedal off my bike. Luckily didn't really get hurt too bad. But was a little banged up and had to walk. I was real young. But probably like 3 or 4 miles. And when you don't know for sure that you're going the right way, that's a terrifying thing to do as a young kid. That's the maybe also, no, I know the most scared I've been. We'll hear that in a minute. You share this bus stop with an old man who shifts from foot to foot, thumbing his suspenders and watching the passing traffic with anxious focus. "Hey," he blurts suddenly, turning towards you. "I want to hear a good story." The air of a man who's distracting himself from something. He stumbles quickly through a tale about the indescribable horror living in the farmhouse cellar. Confusing himself now and again, backtracking, adding new details out of order, you barely piece the story together. You suddenly realize he's told you a twisted version of the story about the abandoned farmhouse, but massively changed, with whole new chunks you don't remember. "It's true," the old man insists, turning his wincing eyes back toward the road. With that, conversation seems over. Chaos, yes, it is the sound of the vagrant song calling you to Gamer Church.
Telling you about what it was like to follow the dead. For a while, that was the life. for a while. They say nothing good lasts forever. But maybe the reason it didn't last forever is because it wasn't as good as we thought, you know? So anyway, got any good ghost stories? Anything scary or weird?
Ghost stories. That's probably a ghost story, but I'm not sure. Let's look around a little bit more. See, spectral seams. Yeah, this is a ghost story. That's a ghost story.
What, do you think that's cool? Sounds more like you made it up.
Shit!
Home. Well, eventually I miss the idea of having a home. A real home. Not a van or a tent. A place I can put down real roots.
Sammy, have you ever heard of Deathbed, the bed that eats? Funny. It's a similar story, you know, a bed that eats people. I don't think this is gonna work. I don't think I have a funny story.
Oh, come on. That shit's so fake.
I'm so close. Look at her eye.
Joy for me. There's nothing like being in the crowd at a show, dancing and spinning and feeling all that energy around you. It's the purest connection I've ever felt. Especially if you're all tripping. Anyway, you got any good, hopeful stories about the world becoming a better place?
I know this one's hopeful.
Oh, that's good. I'll share that one.
Yes.
It was a family. We called it a family. We still do. You can recognize each other if you're hip to it, even off to them. We have our symbols and magic words. You know, I'd love to hear a really good scary story.
Our spookums.
Scary stuff. You are really good at telling these. Past. Sometimes you drop out of the scene and realize that the street world thought you were the past. But the hippie scene was dead and gone.
Is Thanksgiving 3 one of those movies that doesn't have a 1 and 2?
While you were there, it was Tommy's. Anyway, you got any good sad ones stored up? I guess I want to cry a little. You know what happened next? They deserve a little love after that. Sadness. The saddest thing was that the real world followed us in, you did. There were still fights, there was jealousy, people ripping off shit. We were a family. The families have problems too. Well, it's been a while since I told anyone all those old tour stories. Thanks for listening, stranger. I like remembering those days. I'm headed this way. Got a ride to catch. Maybe I'll see you around again.
So you can go back up northeast. Catch her right outside of Washington. And then grab all these stories and talk to her down here. Then back up this way. And that's getting real close. Another one. A long black car growls up in front of this hotel. Out steps a woman in an extravagant hat and coat, followed by a whole crowd of hangers-on. Is she a singer? An actress? You don't recognize her face, but to your surprise, you recognize the story she's telling. In a sharp transatlantic accent, she's telling everyone at her party a story about the haint who craves pig's feet. It's clearly the story of the pig farmers haunted by Meemaw, but changed in a few entertaining ways. So that's something, she asks. Various followers agree. She pays the driver out of the limousine and sweeps into the hotel like a thunderstorm of red velvet. Someone should do a picture about it, you hear her exclaim. All right, chat. I have a mission for you. Google the word haint and then tell me what it means. It's not often that I come across a word that I don't know it. I hope it's not like racist, sexist, ableist. But we'll find out together. A ghost. Okay. After gossiping for a while about the weather and the crops and the state of the world, all bad and getting worse, he takes a different tack. You look like someone who likes a good story, he wheezes. Try this one on for size. After loudly and repeatedly clearing his throat, he tells a story how there ain't been a man hired to do any job anywhere in New York City in over a month. Sounds a lot like the story of the man who had to travel 600 miles to find a single job, but with some parts changed and other parts added. When he grins up at you at the conclusion of the tale, you give him the effusive praise he's apparently expecting. You'll have to remember that version, even if it's not quite what happened. It's a good story. So this is like a southern slang haunt.
Well, hey there. You're getting to be a familiar face. But it's weird. I can't remember what you look like when you're not sitting right there. You ever meet someone like that? Anyway, I guess I should finish the story. Tell you about the commune and bring you right up to the now. Or whatever this town is I'm in. Sometimes it doesn't seem like reality, you dig? I'm stuck in time, maybe, like that one cat in the book. So anyway, got any good ghost stories? Anything scary or weird?
Maybe. Ghost story. This one is probably our best bet here, but we're going to look a little more. That one might be it, too. Actually, I'm going to grab that one. I think that one looks good.
What? Do you sit around all day making this crap up?
Damn it.
Change. Came pretty slow. Things changed only with the seasons and seeing the kids sprout up like trees. There wasn't any bread to buy anything new, and after the first few years, precious few people came or left. But anyway, know any good sad ones? Keep it real, though. Something sad and real. Damn, friend, that's sad. It's me right here. Look, you work as hard as you can, and sometimes a bad season happens. Drought or flood. It's all just fate. You know, I'd love to hear a really good, scary story. Oh man, that's really good. Good and scary, I mean. The commune probably seems like heaven from the outside. You talk to some people about it and they think what we have must be perfect. Everyone just working together and living on the land. I mean, it is pretty great, but it's also hard. A lot harder than it sounds. You know, I'd love to hear a really good, scary story. Don't be a drag. That's not true.
Damn it.
Trapped? Yeah, I think we're mostly trapped by the rest of the world. People just care about money and cars and business. But then I guess they would say we've trapped ourselves. So anyway, got any good ghost stories? Anything scary or weird?
Gonna have to talk to her again. Sorry, I didn't mean to skip that.
You've probably got a long way to travel too, don't you? I found my kind of good life, but I can tell you're still searching for yours. Maybe our paths are gonna cross again. You tend to do that a lot, don't they? Keep looking for me on the roads.
So, I started talking about it a minute ago. Talking about the most scared I've ever been, and I was thinking that it might have been the time I got lost and had to walk my bike back because it had broken. But that's not the most scared I've ever been. The most scared I've ever been was when I almost died. I was at a sailing camp. I already knew how to sail. My family has a boat. It was a smaller boat than I was used to, and we were learning how to swamp them on purpose, and then so we could right them. A lot of bigger sailboats are designed so that they are like physically impossible to permanently tip over. They have what's called a keel, which is very heavy and hangs down below the boat, so that no matter how far it tips, it's always going to right itself. Unless it is broken, it will always right itself. But smaller boats don't tend to have that. They can't drag a weight that heavy and still be good boats. So we were in a decently shallow area, probably like 15, 16 feet deep in the lake. We flipped our boat, and it wasn't coming back up, which meant that the mast was almost certainly stuck on the bottom of the on the lake bed. And we couldn't get it back up. We couldn't wiggle it free. So I took my life jacket off and pulled myself down along the mast to try to get to the bottom and get it uncaught. The boat, I got down there and I like got myself underneath the mast, my back in the dirt at the bottom of the lake, and pushed the mast up. It was like under a rock, and with the leverage that I could get down there, I could push the rock kind of out of the way using the mast. Got it up, no problem. Was swimming back up, and the mast of the boat was swinging this way, and I was swimming this way, away from the mast. A rope from the top of the mast tied around my ankle. And so the mast was trying to go up this way. I was trying to swim up the opposite direction. We reached equilibrium when I was about like 4 feet from the surface. My fingertips were almost touching the surface of the lake. That's the most scared I've ever been, because I was already low on breath because I'd been down at the bottom of the lake for a while, and then I couldn't swim up. As the time I almost died, and I don't go sailing without a knife anymore. The rope just eventually just kind of like untangled itself, and I was able to swim out. But it was not good for a minute there.
This church's doors stand open. You wander in to ask for a glass of water. There's no preacher. Only a disheveled music teacher and a class of young men picking out body songs on the organ. The group can't hear you over an improvised erotic limerick shouted over an equally indelicate tune. The verses escalate to depravity until the music finally swells and comes to the grand finale. Smiling, the teacher invites you to a seat in the pews. A boy returns with water and cookies. And as you eat, the group sings a song about genitalia in perfect three-part harmony.
Wonderful!
The teacher cries.
Again!
I know the song. My ding-a-ling, my ding-a-ling. I want you to play with my ding-a-ling. Oh, it was limericks. Did it say limericks? Oops. Never mind. I don't know the song. So I know the campfire is over there, but I see a little thing right over here on the other side of this mountain. There's a couple of them. Mashmia.
You suddenly become conscious of something heavy in the air. The light of the cigarette breaks the darkness. In its glow, you see the face. Something inside you wishes you hadn't. ¿Quieres esto? He rasps. Then, cigarette. You pluck the cigarette from his fingers, and suddenly, his whole body starts to dissolve. You watch him disintegrate until all that remains of him is on the floor, a disquieting pile of, well, what would you call it? Bone meal?
Chat. I know what you're gonna say. You're gonna say eat the bone meal, But I don't wanna. I want to eat the bone meal. I almost said oatmeal. It's not oatmeal. It's bone meal. They're different things. I don't want to eat the bone meal. I'm gonna eat the bone meal. Not afraid to die. Then in the game.
The bone meal carcass of the cigarette smoking stranger isn't nice to eat. After a couple mouthfuls, you move onwards, feeling interestingly better than before.
What the fuck? 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 Oh, you're right. That is worse. Thanks, buddy.
You come across the two musicians on the corner, playing no louder than a murmur. The blind one to the left doesn't sing so much as moan. If we are willing, he will teach us to love our brothers, to dance and sing. It continues. We dream of his seat in heaven. Around our heads his flowers ring. Oh, Prince in heaven, we sing for rapture. We all must perish, our flowers and our names. But the flowers in our prince's kingdom, they shall not perish, they shall remain. There is a joy there, and there is friendship. For our passage we shall sing. We dream of his seat in heaven. Around our heads his flowers ring. They stop and look at you expectantly, nodding at their empty hat.
Philistine!
One of them calls after you.
Ingrate!
When you don't turn around, they perform the song all over again.
If I'm right, this should be a place to rest. I've noticed some patterns. Yeah. The travelers at this campfire are all women. Women with long knives hanging from their belts. They let you join their camp in exchange for news about the towns you passed to get here. Maybe they're hiding from something, but you feel safe getting a good night's sleep here. Hell yes, the X's give us what we're missing. I'm gonna come back around here. Back on target.
Bang.
and slaps you hard across the face.
Then tell me, goddammit!
He screams, dropping the Bible and grabbing your face with his gnarled hands.
Tell me!
You fend off his scratching and slapping until some good Samaritans drag him off to the drunk tank.
Was not expecting that man to fight me. It's okay, though. We're immortal. We're an immortal skeleton. It's fine. You spend a while in the cool shade at this gas station. You notice three kids sitting beside their family car, while their parents argue loudly with the cashier inside. The children seem embarrassed. You see the oldest brother lean over and distract his siblings with a story. He starts telling them a story about the French spy seeking delivery of coded messages. You realize almost instantly that he's telling a new version of the tale of the mysterious woman with a letter delivery, but with new, exciting, over-the-top details. The parents come stomping furiously out of the gas station. You make yourself scarce, missing the ending of the boy's new story. The part you heard is definitely easy to remember. It'll stick with you for a while. The French spy.
I had me a wife, a baby girl, but no livelihood. I tried my hand at my daddy's factory work, but I wasn't up to snuff. For every bottle I filled on the line, I emptied my soul. When the war started, I figured I'd fight for my country. But they wouldn't take me on account of all those years reading, couldn't see well enough. But the merchant marine, they took me as I am. And then, I had everything. Anyhow, you got any stories that end looking up? I miss those hopeful ones.
You look like you miss the hopeful stories, bud. Hopeful story. We haven't told him a funny story yet. Rose's search is probably helpful.
Leaves a warm feeling in your chest, huh? I had a family, but out on the sea, I got another. One I hadn't reckoned on. Good men all. Crying shame what happened. To all of us. But you know, the books I miss the most is the hopeful ones. Got any of those?
Probably. Is in the heaven, desires fulfilled, wishes come true. It's in the world. I'll try it.
I've seen things 100 times worse than that, I can tell.
Oh, it's scary. Okay.
My wishes. I don't know if they came true.
It's a shooting star.
Well, I read those rags as a kid. Imagine seeing distant shores. That was nothing compared to the real deal. I went further and saw more than any of those writers ever did. But you tell me, what's the wildest thing you've seen on the roads out here? Anything good and exciting?
Boy, do I got an exciting story for you.
My blood's pumping. That's the kind I used to like as a boy. Authority? You pegged me right. Never liked being told what to do.
No, I didn't.
Not the way my father dished it.
I did not peg you right. No, sir.
But when it comes to the sea, you do what you're told.
That was a dirty joke, Chad. Your brothers. I'm sorry, that kind of joke's not appropriate for church.
But you know, the books I miss the most is the hopeful ones. Got any of those? Sure makes me smile.
Got him.
Trust. Thought I trusted Louisa with my heart, with my life. But in too many ports, I learned it's hard to believe in someone who ain't there. Anyhow, you got any stories that end looking up? I miss those hopeful ones. Sure makes me smile. My future. The moment our ship got hit, everything went black. I opened my eyes and nothing changed. I could hardly see. My future ended right there. Well, time to get going. I'm off this way when the sun rises. But talking with you brings it back. The good and the bad. And the bad's what sticks. I died the day my ship was sunk. I fell alive on that sea with my brothers. Knowing I was doing right by my family, my country. Almost wish I never felt that way. Never knew what I'm missing now. Maybe I'll find it here at the bottom of this bottle.
Listen to this, blurts a boy, loitering outside this grocery store. He works his way through a long and strange story about a witch girl who grew kittens on a tree in her backyard like apples. There, he finishes. What do you think? Holy shit, you know this story. It's the story of a witch girl and her kitten familiars, but wildly altered. For a couple moments, you're too surprised to respond. Seriously, the boy insists. What do you think about that one? It's a great story, bud. Smiles sheepishly. Thanks, he says. I heard it from my brother. Where are we headed now? Rose is northeast. I think I want to come down here and grab all these stories, then kind of back up and around. After we talk to this guy, we can maybe fast travel back to Colorado and... Okay. So we're going south, west. Straight south. There's that story. Okay. I got a hangnail on my pinky. I'm trying to, like, chew off but not rip out. I should probably leave it alone and grab it with some clippers. But it rubs on the desktop when I mouse.
Beside this lonely campfire, a familiar, magnificent black horse rears at your presence. A familiar old Stetson-hatted cowboy calls him. Easy boy, Bill says. He turns his attention to you. Sorry, he startles around strangers. Guess he's like me. You want to give him an apple? The horse snorts as you approach. Easy, easy. Bill says again, his voice low and soothing. The horse eyes you warily, but lowers its head to your palm and begins to eat. The cowboy nods as he lifts a tin pot from the flames.
You want a cup of coffee, stranger?
Guessing this is Buffalo Bill. That guy what hunted all the buffalo so that he could make armor and hunt the dinosaurs with. It's a reference to Monster Hunter game last Friday.
Don't get company much, but I try to be hospitable. West's changed. Folks still need each other. The rattlesnake unwinds from his neck and slithers down his arm. Oh, don't worry, he won't bite. There's no animal I can't tame. People, though. He trails off, stares into the fire.
Would have been wild if we randomed into that quote. I do eat children occasionally. It's part of my job.
Pues voy a tirar estas piedras sobre las aguas de esta tierra.
There we go.
Llegarán fuera de aquí.
You did it. Reno. We haven't been to Reno. Guys, we haven't been to Reno.
You,
she snaps.
Level with me now. Would you walk 10 miles every day with heavy bags under your arms and a silly box on your head for some bent, double-crossing, hopped-up, out-of-shape man?
Yes.
Well, so would I.
She smiles weakly.
What is the matter with us, huh?
The hoofbeats of 12 horsemen, their course locked on the mine. White Rider,
White Rider.
Ain't fixing for to join your faded line.
Tiny Motormouth is eagerly sharing the details of a strange tale with her brother as they loiter outside this store. The boy listens raptly, eyes growing larger, mouth hanging open like a fish. Like a fish! He's telling about the trees that sing stories of those departed from Los Angeles. You try to hide your surprise, It's the story of the lingering voices of the Repatriates in Los Angeles. The version the girl must have heard is embellished, to say the least, but hey, it's a good story.
In the morning, migrants lie in the street in an obedient queue, heads down, stomachs grumbling. Every couple minutes, the line lurches forward like the yank of a chain. They're waiting to get into a warehouse. You can't tell why or what's inside. You don't have all day. As you leave, a woman in a ravaged blue petticoat glides past, wrapping her arms around one of the men exiting the warehouse.
I love you,
she whispers.
I love you.
He holds a package, brown paper, with fresh stains the color of rust. This abandoned rail yard is full of broken old boxcars, so of course people are taking shelter here. The looks they're giving you are a little less than friendly. You search around for an empty space to rest.
Vacant boxcar, baby!
There's a heap of rags and sticks in the back of this boxcar. You start digging around, looking for tinder, and the heap starts moving. Hands off, voice yelps. Long, knotty arm with nails like rusty screws darts out and shoves you away. You see big yellow eyes and a flash of snaggle teeth.
This is my home,
the creature informs you.
Are you moving in? We can't. I have the deed for the car. I do the chores around here. I have a lawyer. I'm respected in the community.
You hurry out of the boxcar, and the creature's scabby arm slams the door shut behind you. A few folks in ragged clothes are waiting for you outside.
You should leave,
they tell you. The mayor wants you out. You gotta go. They nod seriously.
He's a big deal around here,
they explain.
He owns the property. He does a lot for us. He has a lawyer,
one of them points out.
You gotta respect a man with a lawyer.
That man didn't have a lawyer. He was a liar. Still southwest? Yeah. Okay. Aha, there it is. There's a story then a campfire.
Full uniform stares fixedly at the horizon. The older guys on the porch are watching him with an expression you read as deep distaste.
That boy wasn't in the war,
one tells you.
His older brother died in France. The junior here tells people he fought, and he stands there in the middle of town once or twice a week in his brother's uniform, so we gotta see it.
He spits in the dirt. The old man's face blooms suddenly and violently red.
Fuck you! You want to see a poor guy?
He lumbers across the street, but a hunting knife you didn't notice emerges from the sheath you didn't see.
Junior!
He shouts.
You piece of shit! Get out of here!
Suddenly, the old man is flat on his ass. Junior sprints into the long grass. As far as you can tell, the old man is unhurt. He cries.
Look what he's done to me!
Rolls up the edge of his shirt. The only wound there is the dark triangle of an old bayonet scar, healed long ago.
I'm from a long line of people that moved on. My grandparents came from Germany because they had to. My husband's parents came west to Ohio, then Missouri, then Oklahoma. My husband didn't have the courage for it in the end. He'd rather drink and die than fight and live. Anyway, know any good hopeful stories to share? I could sure use one.
Hopeful story.
Thank you for sharing that one. I feel a little better now. I haven't heard from my family since they headed back to Oklahoma. The way I see it, my husband killed them, heading back into the dust the way he did. I fought him as hard as I could. But he snuck the girls out of our tent one morning. And they're gone now. I've had a hard day. Do you know any hopeful stories to cheer me up? That's a good one. I'll try to remember it when I'm out in the fields. Trust. The only thing I can rely on is me. I'm not gonna stop trying to live before I die. Some people give up, but they're dutsy. I've had a hard day. Do you know any hopeful stories to cheer me up? Thank you for sharing that one. I feel a little better now. My mother knew how to make her wishes come true. When she wanted something from someone, she used to buy a root called John the Conqueror. She'd chew a piece, and then all stealthy, she'd spit it on the ground by their feet. I doubt it did a thing. But it made her happy thinking she'd tip the outcome. Anyway, I'm looking for a good laugh. Do you know any funny stories?
I do know any funny stories.
Oh, my sides hurt. My past. Well, my son that was born dead, I buried back by our old house in Okemo. And then there were the two girls that lived long enough to come out here before my husband took them back. That's my past. Anyway... Know any good hopeful stories to share? I could sure use one. That's a good one. I'll try to remember it when I'm out in the fields. I loved my husband up to when he took my girls back home. He said he'd rather lie down and die on Oklahoma soil than be spat on here. Well, I can't love someone that gives up. Man or woman, California isn't what they told us. It gets cold here at night, same as anywhere. And the people here weren't happy to see us coming. We spend all day hungry while we're picking lettuce and apricots. Abundance all around. But we don't dare touch it. And there's no more west to go. I'm headed this way to the next job. You say hello if we cross paths again, all right?
I think we're gonna go 1, 2, 3. Yeah.
Looks like the cat's staked its claim.
Share a meal with me?
It asks, swinging tail brushing the corpse.
He's still partly fresh.
It has been a while since you last ate.
We're gonna eat this horse.
Can't be choosy in hard times. You sit with the cat and roast the horse flesh over a fire. It's tender meat. It was a beautiful horse, not much older than a colt.
Ever been in love?
The cat, making small talk.
Have we been in love, chat? Yes.
Have you ever loved someone so much that you could not bear to think of life without them?
Yes.
If you did truly love someone like that, and they didn't know it, and you were brave enough to tell them, and they rejected you? Do you think you would be able to just move on?
You'd have
then
to.
How can that love have ever been that important to you?
The cat scoffs.
I couldn't let go of something.
I knew it.
I wasn't able to. But he's inside me now. And you too.
Cat loved that horse. Then he ate it.
Pues voy a tirar estas piedras sobre las aguas de esta tierra y más tarde.
The child murmurs softly. The woman blurts out a reply.
Don't call me that. Just don't.
When she realizes the impact of her words, her face crumples with regret. and she notices you.
Please, could you help? Have you heard about a missing child? Any reports of a girl like this?
She nods to the girl tucked under her arm. The girl gasps as if slapped and pleads with the woman.
I'm not lost. Why are you being like this? Mother's playing this game. She says she doesn't know me. Of course she knows me, but she won't stop.
There's no particular resemblance between them, but they could still be related. The woman blurts,
I've been ill, feverish, but I wouldn't forget my own child. She can't be mine. But what can I do with her? Thank God. I just wanted someone else to suggest it. They'd consider me a monster just for thinking it, but she's not my daughter. I can't raise her. Life's hard enough as it is.
The child stares at the woman in abject horror, but says nothing.
Anyone ask you to join the communists? A few folks out here have been telling me I should, but I'm not much for joining things. Still, we've gotten to a time where you can't just tell poor folks to move along. Nowhere to move along to. I've had a hard day. Do you know any hopeful stories to cheer me up? That's a good one. I'll try to remember it when I'm out in the fields. In the future, I'm hoping we'll rise up. Enough of us will get angry at how we're treated that we'll say no more. I don't know if it'll ever happen. But oh, I think of it all the time. It's been so long since I last chuckled, I'm not sure my mouth can do it anymore. Can you tell me a story that'll make me laugh? My breath. Joy. The hope of punishing those that made things so hard, that's what makes me smile now. When I hear there's a law coming, or a union forming, or a strike forming up, thinking it might happen is better than anything. Anyway, know any good hopeful stories to share? I could sure.
Hopeful story. Quinn's a wild card that'll work.
Thank you for sharing that one. I feel a little better now. When you travel around enough, you see there's a Hooverville outside of every town. They all look the same. People living in tents and boxes. We should watch tragedy close. Remember it, learn it, and never turn away from it. Tell me a sad story, will you? Thank you. We all hurt the same in times like these.
Yes.
Good to remember that. My family. Well, maybe the girls will grow up to wonder where I am. If they live long enough. But they won't find me. I'm out of family. There's no one here to save me, Scraps, but me. Anyway, know any good, hopeful stories to share? I could sure you. You can't spook me like that anymore. Wishes come true. Well, at some point you stop wanting things to be different just for you. Things need to be different for everyone. Enough food to pick. Good pay for picking it. Hot bath water, no mortgages. And there's enough of us to have nothing left but the will to live. A change will come. A change has to come. I don't know if it'll be communists or unions or someone getting religion in a tent. But you can't stand out the will to live completely. Thanks for talking with me. Not too many have time to listen these days.
Check. Okay. This farmer's loitering beside a couple of crates of berries, idly watching the clouds go by. Waiting for the pickup, he says, trying to make small talk. Hey, you want to hear a wild story? He starts telling you about the sugarcane farmer who killed a cutter every night to ensure a good harvest. It takes a couple minutes, but suddenly you recognize it as a story about the sugarcane farmer who took criminals from the jails and worked them in his fields until they died. Whoever told it to the farmer changed, well, a lot, but it's still pretty good. Oh, I can't remember, he says. I think I've known it for years, since I was a boy, for sure. I'm going to leave him with this tale. You thank him for his story and start to mosey off down the road. Keep cool, friend, he calls after you. Oh no!
A middle-aged man in a suit and a full clown makeup is gobbling down a sandwich. Two tracks of silent tears have carved furrows through his makeup. He gulps hard. Tears start up at the corner of his eyes again.
I'm gonna work for a traveling show. No, that's the problem.
He pulls you into a drunken, one-armed hug and whispers,
he would only hire me as the manager of the clowns.
His eyes are wild and unfocused. Oh God, these tears are real.
I'm not good enough to perform, but they'll let me push paper. That's not the point.
He cries.
Run away with the circus, they say. Run away? I've got three kids. I can't take chances. I need real pay.
He seizes you by the collar.
Never agree to do something you hate,
he says.
If you get too good at it, you'll never do the things you love.
My rider, don't come to
If you told me that I would leave this game feeling sorry for a clown, well, I don't know. I'd probably believe you, but it'd be weird. It's a weird thing to say. Poor guy. More clowns should be happy. That's my hot take. When I pitched into the sand, my legs gave out, my body lacked the strength enough to stand. I think if the clowns were happier, the world would be a better place. Kindly old man sharing the shade under the bridge with you tells you a few rambling stories, some true-seeming, some conspicuously less so. All true, he assures you. There's history in this place, going all the way back to Indian times. Strange stuff happens around here. Well, sure it is, he scoffs. And then, as if to prove himself right, he launches into a story about the soldier who journeyed 20 years for love. And this one, you know. It's the story of the soldier who came home to find his girl getting married, but wilder and stranger than you remember. See then, the old man laughs. So I ain't pulling your leg, it's all true.
The cookhouse is in disarray. Dirty plates and scorched pots scattered outside the tent. A young woman frantically scrubs, muttering. She blanches in panic as you approach, but forces a smile.
Greetings, woman.
She shakes off the suds. Her hands and arms are marked with knife nicks and narrow burns.
Don't mind the mess. You look hungry. Take a seat. I'll work you up a little something.
I will take a seat.
As you sit, her fire-tanned face cracks into a smile. She steps into the tent. There's the discordant clanking and hissing of a cook at work. She emerges with a plate, a blackened sludge of beans and sweaty gray meat.
Eat.
Beans and meat sweat.
She watches intently as you force down the first mouthful. Suddenly, her eyes widen.
I forgot your drink. Let me...
But the fire flares inside the tent.
No!
She gasps, staggering inside. The fire blazes again, and the woman screams. The heat stings as you enter. The tent's a jumble of empty cans, and there's the stink of rotting vegetables and burning meat. Your host is gone. A dark shape squats at the heart of the cook fire. It's time to leave.
Oh, man. She'll be okay, though, right? Surely she'll be okay. I believe.
Word has spread of una huelga, a strike, out in California. It's not uncommon, I have grown used to the frustration and the desperation, seen it rise from its feet and march forth from the fields, but it always ends the same. No one listens. We're beaten down into the dirt and are forced to be comfortable with our discomfort. But it sounds different out in the West. Those Filipinos and Mexicanos have settled their differences, turned frustration into strength, strength into action. I dearly hope I can see it with my own eyes. Please share a story of hope with me. Wonderful story. We need stories like this to give us strength. My family. I'm thinking of sending a letter to Ana Maria when I get to California. It's the closest thing to family I have now. I'll ask about my son, the house, her health. Oh, so much to ask. Maybe you have a good, hopeful story to tell?
We do.
Joy. I remember a time of joy back in Ecuador. Me and my cousins used to play a game where we pretend to be stuck in a forest full of lions, bears, and tigers. We dash across the jardín, the garden, screaming and shouting so loud that the neighbors couldn't help but chuckle at us. I find it hard not to laugh about it as well now that I look back. Do you know anything funny? Anything I can write home about to Mijo? Oh, if Mijo were here, I would tell him that one. I would like to see his little face laugh. My past. Well, when I moved to Mexico, he was well endowed, had money. He lost it all to business he never explained, and gambling he always did. And most of all, he lost respect for me. For to him, I was the burden that led him to his misfortune. A peddler man. I can't believe I fell for his hollow truth. No matter, that's in the past now. Maybe you have a good, hopeful story to tell? What a good story. I will remember it for a while. I know. The future. Oh, I cannot wait to set my feet upon the California soil. It's ay, Dios mío, santísimo. There's so much excitement within me. But no, I can make it. If I manage to roam these Texan fields for years, I can handle walking to the west. Now, tell me a funny story. Make me laugh.
I don't think I have any more of those, guy. There we go, Quinn. Columbia.
Oh, how funny! Thank you. It is not often that I can laugh. Travel. This is the next big journey of my life, I think. I must keep walking west and reach California. Mi mente, my mind is set. I cannot let this chance go. I have to. I need to keep going. El calor feels so intense. Well, I'm not sure if it's the weather anymore. I'm not suffocated by it. It's not just heat, it's warmth, reassurance. Can you feel it? I will follow it. This way, to the west. If you go that way, look for me. I hope we can share together and what we find out there.
She does not seem to be as hurting as the others. Bingo, bango, boingo. Badongo. Okay. This farmer's loitering beside a couple crates of berries. Hey, you want to hear a wild story? Starts telling you about the Thunderbirds, swooping and darting around the high places. Takes a couple minutes, but suddenly you recognize it as a story of the Thunderbird people, who fly when they fall from heights. Whoever told it to the farmer changed, well, a lot, but it's still pretty good. Oh, I can remember, he says. I think I've known it for years. So I was a boy for sure, with his tail. Is it on the other side of the river? It is. I need to cross over here.
Smile creases her face.
This is an excellent spot. Everyone passes me eventually.
She pats the seat beside her.
Join me for a moment.
This woman is sitting on a bench at the gates of hell. That's why everybody passes her eventually.
She rests her head against your shoulder. As if you were old companions.
Look.
She runs a hand on your arm, points across a field to a lone tree silhouetted against the sky.
I think of myself as like that tree.
She glances at you, waiting for a reaction.
Strong, healthy, alone. I've seen that field filled with plants and ravaged by fire. The trees outlasted everything.
She giggles, strangely childlike.
I've had three lovers. Two men, one woman. Outlived them all. I don't grieve. Each one brought me joy, and each death brought someone else to comfort me.
She sits up straight, shifts to face you. The tilt of her head is coquettish.
Would you let me kiss you?
The kiss she plants on you is soft and brief. It would have seemed chaste were it not for the grin of mischief that crosses her face.
Well, that'll bring you good luck. And me, sweet dreams.
She bursts into laughter at your expression and shoos you on your way.
Sammy, did you mean to type LOL? Because you just hit all. Old lady. Listen to this, blurts a boy, loitering outside the grocery store. He works his way through a long and strange story about the girls who could talk to the dead. There, he finishes. What do you think? Holy shit, you know this story! It's the story of the girls who search for haunted houses, but wildly altered. For a couple moments, you're too surprised to respond. Seriously, the boy says. What do you think about that one? Great story. Smile sheepishly. Thanks. Heard it from my brother.
I'm happy to see you again. It feels like years have passed. Years of energy once wasted, now keeping me alive with purpose. I would have never imagined myself being here, my faith resolute, among crowds of new friends and compatriotas. My mother and son's presence with me, easing the pain in my hands and in my body. A blessing from God and from My Lady of Guadalupe, gracing me with determination. I move with my hermanas y hermanos as one, and my soul is one, free from the ire of my past. I never thought I'd see myself like this, and I weep with joy that I am. Please share a story of hope with me.
That might be it. That might be it.
What a wonderful story.
Socialism.
We need stories like this to give us strength. Oh, my faith. It's been such a great reward. When I arrived here, I was close to fainting. Two young men held me up and walked me to a small building near the fields. The door opened, and before me was a shrine for My Lady of Guadalupe, stretching across half the wall, candles and flowers adorning the floor. I couldn't hold my tears back. It's the closest thing to a sign of God that I've witnessed. Maybe you have a good, hopeful story to tell? What a good story. I will remember it for a while. I know. My family? I received a letter back from Ana Maria. She says she's well, and she's now living with relatives in Laredo. The last few words almost made my corazón stop. It wasn't Ana's handwriting. I wait for you, madre mía. May God bless you with amor, tu hijo, my son. Please share a story of hope with me.
What do we think? The man who ate only molasses, Cassidy's verse, girls who could talk to the dead. This isn't under love. Did this turn into a story of hope? He journeyed 20 years for love. I think I'm gonna try that.
And that's real sadness to you?
Oops, nope. That's sad.
More travel awaits me. They say we'll march to the capital. Sacramento, I think it's called. I don't know if my feet will handle it after traveling all the way from the east. If I get better and my body is capable, I'll be sure to be at the front of the crowd. Now, tell me a sad story. A true one. Don't go away so easy. They stick with you forever, reminding you of your humanidad, your humanity. Now, tell me a funny story. Make me laugh.
This is joy. It's probably not gonna work. But we'll see.
Do not trick yourself, friend. Life does not work like that. I know joy now. Loneliness eats you up. It breeds resentment, coldness. Yet when you're in the presence of comunidad, of community, you feel enlivened. Through others, I've come to discover new things about myself, pulled from the wisdom and grace of others. And I couldn't be more grateful for that. Well, I must go.
Damn.
I am sorry to leave our conversation unfinished. I hope you will be safe on the road. We are all so blessed to be here, in this time, this place. My friend, we will change the world.
So what do you think about this sailor man? It's hard to not feel sorry for everyone. Beckons you into the church and starts counting out of the donations box. Hush, he says, trying to silence your thanks. He piles the coins into your hand. You look like you need it more than we do. I didn't. I was full of money. It's okay. Oh, no, I wasn't. I've got that train so long ago. Like at the beginning of the stream. I've been low on money since then. Let's get that train. Thank you, Preacher Man. This man can barely wait to get through the pleasantries before asking if you've heard this story. 110% true, he says. I heard it from my nephew and it happened to someone he knows well. Man launches into his telling. It's polished, but he obviously has done this many times before. He tells you the story of the spirit of the buffalo, which must run each year to protect its kind from extinction. You recognize the bones of it from your experience of the spectral riders who hunt the ghosts of buffalo. It's been embellished in the interim, though. This guy has big J. Jonah Jameson energy. Bring me pictures of Buffalo Man! Afterwards, you thank the man and move on. You thank the buffalo and move onwards. You have to remember that version, even if it's not quite what happened. It's a good story. Yeah, it's the stash. And the skinny, long face.
Afternoon. The fish nods after.
Oh, I love him.
He swings his catch over his shoulder, grunting with effort. Got a big one today. Gonna eat it while it's fresh. They're welcome to join me. There's plenty to go around.
He climbs off the jetty and lays the body on a large rock. He works with practiced efficiency. To remove the shirt, the fish cradles the body in his arms. When he removes the man's trousers and underwear, the gesture he uses to lift the corpse's hips is almost intimate. It seems the fish is taking care to not cause bruising. The fish trims the man's hair, head, chest, groin, even legs. Then he stabs the knife into the man's chest, leaning hard to force it open. The bones part with a crack. Fish guts the corpse and tosses away the offal.
You gonna help me get it on the fire?
You prop the body up while the fish skewers it on a rough spear. The corpse sags in your arms like a drunk. Together, you lay the body over a pit of hot coals. Its flesh sizzles. There's a sharp, sour smell, swiftly overwhelmed by the odors of cooked fat.
I'm going to breathe in the hearty aromas.
Tantalizing, isn't it? Smell alone makes me famished.
The fish rolls his eyes in a melodramatic expression of desire. He flips the body over and tests it with a fork.
This bit's ready. Want some?
I'm gonna eat the man.
The flesh is chewy, rich, and oozes flavor. It is the sweetest of savory dishes. The warmth trickles down your throat and stokes your hunger. This is a meal that leaves the diner craving, not sated.
Don't rush it,
the fish warns.
You'll get hiccups.
You ever eat a man with a fish?
Crowds that sunk my ship took most of my side in the blast.
Came home, couldn't work, couldn't read. But I could drink. That I could do. Easy as falling off a log. And I could lose my family. I could do that too. But you tell me, what's the wildest thing you've seen on the roads out here? Anything good and exciting?
This is probably exciting.
Ooh, tell another like that and you could ride a good ride. Authority. I swore an oath to it. I swore to follow my superiors to the best of my ability. But what was their oath to me? Where's their loyalty when I need it? So I miss them blood-pounding adventure stories. You got any like that? That's the kind of adventure that sticks with you. This country. Navy wouldn't have me, but the mariners would. Until they wouldn't. What's it say about a country if it breaks its people and throws them away? Anyhow, you got any stories that end looking up? I miss those hopeful ones. Sounds like it wants to be a story from the good old rags, but it ain't there yet. Travel taught me lots. I'd seen this world plenty. Beggars in every bar and port reach out with gnarled hands. But before it happened to me, I never seen anything like the way this country treats its servicemen. But you know, the books I miss the most is the hopeful ones. Got any of those?
I'm out of hope. I don't have any more.
Leaves a warm feeling in your chest, huh? But my family. Don't talk to me about my family. Louisa could have helped me. She could at least tried. If I'd let her. But you tell me. What's the wildest thing you've seen on the roads out here? Anything good and exciting? Blood's pumping. That's the kind I used to like as a boy. Freedom. Yeah, I got nothing holding me back now. Just me and the bottle and the road. Brothers left me. Wife and kid left me. Country left me. Spend our whole lives living for the future, never realizing that when it comes, we'll have been forgotten. Sorry, mouth is dry from all this talking. And I reckon I got nothing left to say.
open the box. What box? The box you're talking about? Pandora's box. You would. Seeing as your name is what it is. You would just love me to open that box, wouldn't you? You're waiting for it. Isn't there a new one of them puzzle box horror movies coming out? The You know the one with the needle face guy. You know the one. Isn't there one of those coming out soon?
Matched set of horseshoes tethered to the top with colorful string.
I wish I knew where it went,
he mutters. He glances up and startles.
I know you. We've met before, haven't we? I know you.
He stands, triumph in his smile.
It's been 50 years, but I'd recognize you anywhere, General.
He fingers his lapel.
I don't have it anymore, but I remember that day so well. You shook my hand.
He offers that hand to you. There's a jolt as your palms meet. The sky grows dark. A faceless crowd gathers. A hodgepodge of uniforms and insignia. The old man smiles. Years. Melt from him.
And then you said...
The response leaps from your tongue. This is for your bravery. There's a medal in your hand. He grins, salutes. The horde around you falls. 100 spectral soldiers dropping into the dirt. You step back. The darkness recedes, and the world is as it was. But the old man still wears the medal.
Well, how about that? Thank you, stranger.
Long black car growls up in front of this hotel. Out steps a woman in an extravagant hat and coat, followed by a whole crowd of hangers-on. Is she a singer? An actress? You don't recognize her face, but to your surprise, you recognize the story she's telling. In a sharp transatlantic accent. She's telling everyone at her party a story about Minneapolis, torn apart in a shooting war between the strikers and cops. It's clearly the story of the cops who went to war against strikers in Minneapolis, but changed in a few entertaining ways. So that's something, she asks. Various followers agree. She pays the driver of the limousine and sweeps into the hotel like a thunderstorm of red velvet. Someone should do a picture about it, you hear her exclaim.
I knew we'd run into each other again. You got a way of turning up. Do you want to hear more about the commune? Sure, I can tell you. I'm so grateful I ended up there. But it's hard work. Harder work than most people realize, I think. But anyway, know any good sad ones? Keep it real, though. Something sad and real.
There it is.
They deserve a little love after that. Family. Yeah, they're my family. We all take care of the kids and each other. We bicker and fight, sure. But it's so nice having such a big family to watch each other. So anyway, got any good ghost stories? Anything's... Oh, wow, that's scary stuff. You are really good at telling me. Change. Came pretty slow. Things changed only with the seasons and seeing the kids sprout up like trees. There wasn't any bread to buy anything new, and after the first few years, precious few people came or left. You know, I'd love to hear a really good scary story. Really good. Good and scary, I mean. The commune probably seems like heaven from the outside. You talk to some people about it and they think what we have must be perfect. Everyone just working together and living on the land. I mean, it is pretty great, but it's also hard. A lot harder than it sounds. Anyway, you got any good hopeful stories about the world becoming a better place? Sit around all day making this crap up?
Oof.
Our morality? We still live the values. Even more, really. No burning gas up chasing the band, and we worked for our own food, and it all came straight from the earth. You know, I'd love to hear a really good scary story. Some kind of dumb movie. Our future? There's no reason the farm can't last forever. Until we blow up the earth or pave everything over, anyway. I have a feeling we may not see each other again. But I've told you my whole story, and you're still making yours. Be well, stranger.
I think that's going to do it for us. I'm going to grab this story. It's her again. Suicide Cult of Acid Heads. Just three left, right? One, two, three. Four. Okay, we're not doing this tonight. Next time on Dragon Ball Z. We'll finish this up. We're going to do it. I have faith. I have hope. Thank you guys for joining us. Tomorrow night, we're going to continue Nathan's godforsaken mono shiny Nuzlocke. Wednesday, we'll probably, maybe, the boys are free, so we might do my 100 battles run on Pokemon Coliseum. Wednesday night. And then Thursday and Friday we'll be playing Monster Hunter because new update. Gosh, that game sure is worth buying. They have free title updates all the time. And it's good. We are playing the hell out of it. Thank you guys for stopping by tonight. I'll see you next Sunday for Gamer Church. Goodbye.